Smile, smile, smile. Make your world so much brighter. Is so much more than treasure. It's the way to health and happiness. Life will be a pleasure. When you leave the house, smile at everyone you see. Spread a little joy and sunshine with everyone you meet. Smile, smile, smile. Make the world so much brighter. Smile, smile, smile. Make the world so much kinder.
Okay, welcome to Dhammakaya Open University Dhamma Talk, English version. Today, our topic is, what if we know how the mind works? We will discuss about how the mind and the body work together. My name is Prachayanon Gijananto. The topic is about what would happen if we know how the mind works. Okay, let me share the screen, share the PowerPoint. Okay. Okay, my name is Prachayanon Gijananto. What we talk about, the body and mind. Human being comprised of the body and the mind. What is the relationship between the mind and the body? If I compare, it's like puppeteer and the puppet. The mind work as a puppeteer to pull the string and make the body, which is the puppet, work according to the puppeteer pull the string. So the body, if we have only the body, we don't have mind. It's like a dead body, you know, that it's like a corpse. But if we have only mind and we don't have the body, we call ghost. So to be complete human being, we gotta have mind and body. So let's see how it works together. The components of human being. We have body, what we see, what we hear, what we smell, what we taste, and what we feel of the touching through the body. See through your eyes, hear through your ear, smell through your nose, taste through your tongue, and the feeling through your touching. The brain controls the body, control every part of the body. If I compare to the computer, the body is like a computer. We have screen, we have keyboard, we have mouse, we have everything. That's a hardware. And the operating system is like the brain. The brain will control every part of the body. The operating system, like a Windows, Mac OS, Android, it's operating system to control hardware, every part of the hardware. The decision of the brain is limited to a certain part. The part that controlling every part of the body, not the decision making. The mind, when we see through our eye, to our ears, to our nose, to our tongue, to our feeling of touch, those information will send to the mind. The perfect perception is at the mind's level. The mind will receive those information. You know, information may be like a digital signal. The image we see, the song we hear through the brain, it's not complete perception at the brain's level. They are sent to the mind, and the mind is the one who perceive that. Record and make decision. After making decision, the mind will command the brain to react. Suppose somebody walked to you and slapped your face. You see the guy walking in. You hear the sound of being slapped. You feel hurt. Those information, the brain just collect those information and send to the mind. The perfect feeling of touching, feeling of hearing the noise of being slapped, the feeling of seeing the guy walking in, is at the level of the mind. And the mind will record those record is at the mind's level. The mind will record everything happened. And then make decision and command the brain to react. In this case, the mind might say, hey, hit it back. And the brain will move hands, leg, everything to react that. Or the mind may say, let him go. Just forgive them. This is the mind is the one who make decision, not the brain. And how can the mind and the brain communicate with each other? You know, the brain is here, fixed with the body, but the mind travel anywhere. How can the mind communicate with the brain? The consciousness is the means of communication. Consciousness is the means of communication. When you are awake, you are conscious. The consciousness works like a Wi-Fi, like an internet to connect the mind and the brain. But when you fall asleep, the consciousness is going away. When you reach the complete sleep, the consciousness is gone. So let's see how it works. The brain is here at the body, and the mind travel everywhere. Whatever you think of, your mind is there. So the consciousness work like a network or internet or Wi-Fi or whatever to communicate between the brain and the mind. The function of the mind, number one, to sense or to perceive, to see image to your eye, hear the song to your ears, smell something through your nose, taste something through your tongue, and feeling the touching through your skin, as I told you, the complete perception is at the mind level. The body, the brain, is just a hardware to perform those things. But real perception is at the mind level. Number two, to memorize and retrieve. Whatever the mind perceives, it's recorded in the mind's memory. And later on, when we see something or see someone, information from your eyes will go to the mind, and the mind will recall from the memory, retrieve from the memory. Recognition of something or someone is at the mind level. Number three, to think. We try everywhere to develop the way we think. Meeting, brainstorming, seminar, learn, everything. Try to develop the way we think. But unfortunately, in our educational system, both the West and the East, we teach only three functions of the mind: to sense, to perceive, to memorize and retrieve, to think. But to enter to the fourth function of the mind, remember this, to enter to the fourth function of the mind, we have to stop those three functions first. If you're still sensing, if you still recall something, if you're still thinking about something, we cannot reach the fourth function of the mind, which is the fourth function is having known the supreme wisdom, supreme knowledge, which is required to seize those first three functions. See, this is why when we practice meditation, those three functions will keep bothering you. Think of something, recall some memory, and sensing. So those keep disturbing your meditation. It's hard to still your mind. It's hard to stop thinking. The nature of the mind, traveling alone. See, it's true, traveling alone, your mind. Two people sleep in the same bed, holding each other's hand and say, let's go dreaming together. Can they do that? No. Even the moment to fall asleep are different. How can they holding each other's hand and go dreaming together? They may meet each other in the dream, in the part of the dream, but not along or along the way. The mind travel faster than the speed of light. The light traveling from the sun to the earth takes 8 minutes something. But the mind travel faster than that. Suppose the guy travel from this corner room to that corner room with the speed of light. How much time he spent? Zero, because very short distance, and it takes very, very less in traveling. Take possession of a body. The mind will take possession of a body. It can be a human being, it can be animals, it can be a celestial body. But when did the mind take possession of our body? When? Since we were born? No, before that. Since you are sperm, millions of sperm try to get into one egg. But only that guy that the mind take possession can get into that egg. The egg say, oh, no, not other. It must be that guy. That guy say, hey, only me can get into that egg. Except twin, they come together and get into the egg at the same time. Be wherever the thoughts are. Whatever you think of, your mind is there. You think of someone, your mind is there. You think of somewhere, your mind is there. You think of Jupiter, your mind is there. You think of Mars, the mind is there. Because it's travel faster than the speed of light. Because your mind is very efficient, very powerful. The defilement control the mind. The defilement control the mind. Come back to the puppeteer and the puppet. We heard that the mind control the body like a puppeteer control the puppet. But in upper level, the defilement work like a puppeteer to control the mind. See, the defilement control the mind. And unfortunately, we don't realize that we are in control. We don't realize that we are in control of the defilement. Because the defilement works, have worked since we were born to disturb by disturbing, by intruding, by control, by lure our mind. And our mind feel that it's a pressure. It's kind of pressure to be controlled by the defilement. So what we try to learn today is to see that we are controlled by the defilement. To realize that what we would do if we realize that. Let's see the category of the defilement. The enemy of the body is like a viruses, bacteria, and some other thing. But the real enemy of our mind are defilements. We have three categories of defilement. First one is greed and lust. We need something, but what we want is more than what we need. Beyond the need is greed. Also the lust in this the same category. The second category hatred. Hatred starts from annoyance. Annoyance, hatred, anger, revenge. Many people say that if somebody hurt you or say something bad to you, many people say, I have the right to be angry. I have the right to be angry. They don't realize that what do they get from that anger? It's only hurt yourself whenever you recall that. Whenever you recall that, it keeps hurting yourself. Not the one who hurt you, but it hurts yourself every time. Particularly, if you cannot forgive yourself, you hurt yourself. You hurt you and yourself twice. The third category is delusion. Delusion is the state of not using knowledge. The state of not using knowledge, stimulated by envy, jealousy, rivalry, illusion, deceit, trick, treachery, heedlessness, obstinacy, immobility. Let me show you one example of delusion. Prejudice. The stimulus for delusion. we have prejudice of like, prejudice of dislike, prejudice of fear, and prejudice of being fooled. Let me show you an example. When you look for a new car, you go shopping, many brand, brand A, brand B, brand C, try to collect the strong point and the weak point of each brand. But when you make decision, what ground that you make decision? You make decision, if suppose you like brand A, you choose brand A. Because you like brand A. Those information that you collect, the weak point or the strong point, whatever, collect that in order to answer your friend when your friend asks you, why, how come you choose brand A? So you have information to tell your friend. But probably you made decision before you went shopping because you like brand A. The brand A is in your mind and you already made this decision before you went shopping. The prejudice of dislike now. For brand B, when you went shopping, brand B, because you like brand A, the salesman of the brand B try to convince you. In the end, you have quarrel with the salesman of brand B. You come back and say, I don't choose brand B. Not because of the quality of the car, but because of you have quarrel with the salesman of brand B. This is the prejudice of dislike. So the guy go to his dad. Dad, buy me a new car. Dad say, what would you like, son? I like brand A. The dad say, why don't you choose brand B? Because it's better than brand A. Blah, blah, blah. Have discussion with the son and the dad for a while. In the end, dad say, okay, if you choose brand A, you pay for yourself. If you choose brand B, I pay for you. What's the decision now? Well, okay, because it's prejudice of fear. You are afraid of paying by yourself, you change your mind to choose brand B. The last category is prejudice of being fools. A friend of you come to you and say, don't go to that restaurant. It's very expensive. The second friend come to you, said, don't go to that restaurant, the same restaurant. He said, the waiter and waitress are very aggressive. Okay, you heard that. The third friend of you come to you and see, don't go to that restaurant, the same restaurant. You know, the kitchen is very filthy, very dirty. You heard that. Have you ever been there? No. Are you going to prove that word? No. But how can you okay, for a while. For a while. But the guy believed without proving. But the guy believed it. Believed for a while. And then the guy go to tell other people what he had been told. Blah, blah, blah. Has he ever go to that restaurant? No. Is he going to prove that word? No. But how can he tell other people what he has been told? Because this is the prejudice of being fooled. Choose to believe something without proof. He is not stupid. Probably he is well educated, but he choose to believe without proving. Now we know the things that this distraction make your thought believe in something without proving. That's we have to remove the distraction thoughts. We must realize that what makes us think that way, should we prove before we believe, before we take action something. This is what the evil make the defilement, you know, put something in your head and make you believe. Sometimes give you some pressure, not happiness, only pressure, make pressure to make you feel good, not happiness. The happiness is something above those things. So if we have time, next time we talk about that between pressure and happiness. So what would we do if we know the distracting thought? Eliminate that thought. You know, the defilement control the mind. The mind control the brain control the body. So the deep root of the problem is defilement. So what should we do? Get rid of those defilement. Get rid of those defilement. Eliminate all thoughts. Be yourself. Prove that before believed in something. Okay, today we talk about the mind and the body, the relationship between the mind and the body, and we talk about the defilement control the mind. The mind control the brain. The brain control the body. So when we go down to deep root of the problem is defilement. When we realize that the defilement is the deep root of everything, get rid of that. That's the conclusion of Dhamma Talk today. Thank you, everybody. Have a patience to hear the Dhamma Talk today. Okay, anybody have a question? Anybody have question? เพราะว่าไงนะทำไมจะต้องเรียนวิชาการเรียนหัวข้อ Why we talk about this topic, right? Because we don't, unfortunately, we don't realize that we have been controlled by the defilement, the mind is controlled by the defilement, and we don't realize that we are controlled by the defilement. That's the problem. Today's discussion try to make you realize that you are controlled by the defilement. You have been controlled by the defilement since you were born. And we don't realize that. We enjoy the pressure that defilement gives you. If we realize that, we get rid of the defilement by killing your thought. You know, the defilement work very easy. It's very easy to work. They do nothing but make you think of evil things. make you think of evil things. When we know, when we realize that, we should get rid of our thought, our evil thought. Think of good thing, think of wholesome deed, not thinking of evil. That's why we try to make us understand this. If you understand this, then you can get rid of the evil thought. Our main destination is being very good in meditation. If we still have our mind travel, have our mind wander everywhere, then we still being controlled by the defilement. We should get rid of that. Any more question?
Mm-hmm. Or from
pure energy. Our mind is kind of pure energy. The defilement is kind of pure energy. We cannot see it, we cannot feel it, we cannot hear it. But whenever the mind, wherever the mind is, the defilement are ready to take control of that. They are both pure energy.
They're stronger than mine.
Sometimes, most of the time, I said, most of the time, the defilement are stronger because they have more power. And they have something to learn. They try to put pressure and joy to learn your mind. So you enjoy and you have enjoyed that pressure and you go along with the defilement easily. That's why.
But if we don't have any pressure at all, then how do we feel? I mean, like that any kind of feeling we can feel in our body?
It's we get pressure and joy in return. Since we were born, for example, we eat something and we keep telling ourselves that, oh, this thing is delicious since you were born. So it in the deep memory of joy. If somebody say, hey, that food, that kind of food, is allergic or is not bad, it's kind of bad thing that you should do, you eat it. It's hard to persuade you because you have been familiar with with that kind of food since you were born. Someone tried to change to be a veggie. Most of them take a long time to you know, try to change, set the mindset that, or keep telling themselves that eating meat is not good or something like that. It takes some time to convince yourself. My and body and mind is quite very basic in Buddhism. In other belief, they don't believe that we have mind, we have body. That's why when they try to do the research about how the brain works, they put a lot of effort to do the research about the brain work, because they don't believe that there is a mind. But in Buddhism, the Buddha have rediscovered that we have the mind and the body. This is quite very basic. So this is, I think this is important to show the world that the mind and the body exists no matter they believe it or not, but it exists.
The brain is like a
operating system that control the hardware. But if we want to work on computer, we gotta have program or some program to run on the computer. The operating system is working between the application and the hardware. So the brain is more or less the same as working, the same as the operating system to communicate between the mind and control the body. You know, this very close to each other. The brain controls the body. The operating system controls the hardware. If we want something out of the computer, we gotta have some program, some application to run on the computer. And the operating system do the service job between the application and the hardware. The brain doing the same thing to is the means between the mind and the body. Because the mind cannot direct our hand, our foot directly. The brain controls that. So the mind gotta command the brain to control our hand, our speech, our action. So I think this is very important in Buddhism to show the world that this exists no matter how the world believe it or not. What's the next? Meditation? Okay, let me give some idea before we meditate. Let me give some idea. We probably don't have time to meditation today, but let me give some idea in meditating. We have two problems. First problem that we have been talking about, that the defilement make us recall something in the past and keep bothering us while we practice meditation. So what we try to do is to eliminate those thoughts. This is one thing. And the second thing is we have been trained since we were born that when we try to steal our mind, eliminate our thought, and our mind getting steal to a certain level, that point, that intersection, we are going to sleep. We have been trained that when we reach that, we are going to sleep. So when we practice meditation, along the way we practice meditation, we still our mind, eliminate our thought. If we have some depression and we keep thinking of something all the time, we cannot sleep, right? But if we stop thinking and we reach that point, we are going to sleep. By habit, we are going to sleep. So what we try to do in meditation, when our mind getting still, just be conscious. Just be conscious. If you are conscious and you can eliminate all thought, that's good for practicing meditation. But if you reach that point, you fall asleep. you try to keep yourself conscious. But if you are mindful with something, like it is force yourself to be awake, that's another problem. That's another problem. So, you know, the problem in practicing meditation, it's something like that. We don't have time to practice meditation today, but let me give you some idea in practice meditation, that when we kill our thought, still our mind, then we going to sleep. We try to draw it back, be conscious. When we try to be conscious, sometimes we are too mindful with our mind. If you too mindful, it, you know, it kind of you stop yourself with somewhere, not going to the stillness, to the complete stillness. That's problem of practicing meditation. I think it's good to give you some idea when we have time to meditate together next time, and this idea will help you to control yourself, not to be mindful, to over mindfulness, not to be let yourself falling asleep, not to follow your thoughts somewhere else. Your thought go to your friend, go to your somewhere, your work, your future. Draw your mind back. Keep it inside. It is not too hard to do, but it's not too easy to do. Next time when we meet again, I hope we have time to practice meditation together. Okay. I hope it's useful for all of you today. And let me give you some blessing before we end the program. Okay. Let all merits that you have cultivated and accumulated for many lifetimes bring you happiness and success, bring you longevity with good health, and help create loving kindness, compassion, and generosity within your mind throughout your whole life and the lifetimes to come. Good day and good night, everybody.
Here is the opportunity to be a part of history by studying the enlightenment of the Lord Buddha. You could become a DAU student in the Dhammakaya Open University, now accepting applications for new students in English. Apply at DOU Office 100 Building, 2nd from Monday to Saturday. On Sunday, register at DOU Booth at the N26 poll at the Dharmakaya Assembly Hall. The website is www.dou.us.